second part of our meeting. This is a workshop, and this is, like we said early on, this is a model that we are going to implement throughout all our international meetings. In this meeting, we have the pleasure to hear a presentation from Mr. Gumersindo. And we're trying to learn from the local city what is their policies, the integrity policy in terms of regional approach. And so we expect that we can learn from this presentation and use the contents in the future for our future discussions and work. So I'll pass the word to Mr. Gumersindo. Thank you, and have a nice workshop.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Okay. I am here on behalf of Fundacion Santa Maria de Real. It's a non-profit, private, cultural entity, Spanish foundation, that is working on heritage development. So, I would like to talk about some questions that we should answer in Europe. This kind of projects are useful for answer these questions. I think we can discuss after the presentation. But these are the topics that today are in our mind and are in our discussion, internal discussion inside the Fundación Santa María de Real. The title of this presentation, the title of this speech is "Even a Ring Can Be a Hope." This is a sentence that comes from a very well-known writer, a Spanish writer that is called Miguel de Unamuno. This person in the first part of the 20th century decided to visit some places all around Spain. He visited Aguilar de Campo. It's the place where I come from. Aguilar de Campo is in the north part of Spain. You can see the province of Palencia, Palencia with P, not with V. That is different, we don't have C. And it's in the plateau of Castilla y León. It's an elevated place. And the problem that we have is that we are living in a depopulated area, very aged area, with few people, and we are living in a rural area. Aguilar de Campo has only 8,000 people living there, okay? It's a small village. And Miguel de Unamuno said, even a ring can be a hope, when he visited the monastery of Santa Maria la Real. The monastery of Santa Maria la Real was a real monastery that is one of the, I can say, hundreds of monasteries that were ruined in the first part of 20th century, because in the 11th century, some political decision caused this situation. Okay. What can you see here? It's a ring, it's a hope, we don't know. Really, the popular call, the name of this monastery was Convento Caído, the ruined monastery, okay? You can see different places inside the monastery. So, disaster. This is it was a monument that was restored by the entity that I am representing here. Fundación Santa María la Real started in 1977 to work to restore this building, and today it's a high school. Also is the place where the National Distant University has the office in Aguilar de Campo to serve to the people, the local people. And today it has also a Romanesque and territory museum, because in the area we have plenty of Romanesque remains, And today also we run there on a hotel and a restaurant. So for me, the important question is that, okay, it's important that a monument that was protected, it was listed by the government of Spain, it was a national monument. It's important to restore a national monument. But for me, it's more important the impact that this restoration has in the territory. Because from being a passive asset, it's an active asset that helps people to study, learn, have employment there, because it's a place where a lot of people is studying there, because it's a high school, and we have there are many employees that are working in this monument, in this place, with a different point of view, because they are using a national monument in a normal way. So after 40 years, this is, you can see here some figures that offer a quick vision of our entity today. For me, this slide could be a little bit rude, taking into account that many people want to start doing things in their communities. For me, it's a rude slide. Please. Antonio. Okay, I prefer talking about the some people that in the past century decided to work for free. The neighbors of Aguilar de Campo started a movement in this time when it was not usual the awareness about the preservation of heritage. These people started to work there for free, and they created a movement that helps to raise the awareness about how important was the conservation, the preservation of heritage for the future or local communities. This man is our former president, is a well-known architect in Spain and a very well-known cartoonist in the newspaper called El País. It's one of the most important. And he lived close to this monastery, and he promoted a civil movement to restore this monument. In this process, what we have built is a community of people that is interested in heritage, especially Romanesque monuments. There's a very strong movement of people interested in Romanesque. But it's important for me that local neighbors take the responsibility of caring of their own heritage. What? It's better now? Yeah. Okay. Okay. But the important thing is for me that in this process the community has taken the responsibility of restoring, knowing all the things about heritage. You can think we are a private entity, we are not administration, so we have a different point of view sometimes to the administration. Okay, for me it's very important. And I would like to show you some cases of innovation related with the activity that we have promoted. In this early 80s, in the last century, the problem in Spain was the unemployed people without the skills, without the profession. And the Fundacion Santa Maria Real decided to promote workshop schools that we call in Spanish escuelas talleres, casas de oficios, and it was a promotion. It was promoted by our former president, the person that I have shown you before. It's a
critical project that was spread all around Spain and South America, and it was sponsored by the Ministry of Labor. And there are more than 700,000 people that have been participating inside this project. We promoted this, we started preparing this project, and the first edition of this model of workshop school, in which young people started to gain skills, labor skills, and a profession, they recovered, they started to learn ancient trades. So it was a critical use of people and employees that started to learn new trades, restoring old buildings. And the impact in Spain has been great. Another social innovation from our point of view that was promoted for us is the non-permanence, territorial intervention. In this case, we have changed the point of view from restoring a single building to restore a group of buildings in a territory, putting together natural resources and cultural resources. The impact of this type of projects is very high, because we have restored 54 Romanesque churches in the area, in a small area, and what we have at the end is a tourist label, a tourist brand, is called Romanesque, North Romanesque, and the people identify our territory with Romanesque. After an intervention in all 54 churches. Another one, in this case, is similar to the previous project. This is Atlantic Romanes, in which we have been collaborating with the government of Portugal, the government of Castilla y León, and a private foundation that is Fundacion Iberdrola. Iberdrola is an energy company that have interest on the north of Portugal, and they decided to participate collaborating on restoration of heritage. We have been working on there. We still are working on this project, and this is a clear case of public and private partnership that we have heard about this kind of partnership a lot of time, but it really on heritage management is very difficult to find clear evidences, at least in Spain, of private and public partnerships. And this is another case. This is not related with heritage, but it's related with a problem. We also have the need, the social need, of, as a key factor for preparing programs and projects. This is Lanzaderas de Empleo, it's a career booster, we call that. And Lanzaderas de Empleo is focused on helping unemployed people all around Spain to recover their employments or to find a new employment. Okay? We have had 6 million unemployed people in 2008. 2009, 2010, there was in Spain 6 million of unemployed people. And we decided to start doing something. And we start putting together unemployed people and helping them to recover their skills, their transversal capabilities, and they have found, most of them, new jobs. Why? Because we have been working with them in order to boost their capabilities. But it's not related with heritage, it's related with people. We try to restore the heritage, people, and landscape. Okay. So, the entity that I'm representing here is very... we have very different activities inside, but you can see most of them are related with employment. We use heritage as
mechanisms to offer employment for the local people. So we can see here some activities. I would like to stress the monitoring heritage system, that is the system that we have developed in order to promote the preventive preservation of buildings. And we have developed a software and hardware system in order to monitor all the buildings. You can see here other different activities that we have promoted. We are participating in European programs like INT-HERIT buildings, Smart Heritage City, with these projects are in the INT-HERIT SUDOE program. And these are the activities that we are developing today. One point that is important for us is how we can work with others. For a private entity without funding schemes that are fixed, we need to work with public administration and private entities. And we have built a network of entities that are working with us, promoting and helping us to develop the projects that we are leading. The key points that I would like to stress from the few slides we have seen are this one. For me, social initiative is very important. We are in the social third sector, and for us it's important that some civil society could have a lead position on solving the social problems. We transform the need on opportunities. We can always see opportunities to develop new projects. It's important that the leaderships, the civil leadership, and we are really more active than activists. That means that other entities always focus on the problems. We focus on the opportunities, on the solutions. That is a critical and a good situation. What are the challenges that we are facing today? For us, we are in the starting point for our radical social transformation. With this movement of transforming industries, transforming the labor market, we are facing demographic changes. For example, it's very important in Spain how the main important area, or the center of the country, is being depopulated. And we are facing new social exclusion situations, because maybe a lot of people is going to be out of the trend, out of the digital society we are building. So for us, we need to work with these people, and we need to work looking for new uses of heritage, because it's impossible to keep and maintain all the heritage that we have in Spain, for example. Yesterday we were talking about, in relation with castles, we have in Spain, Antonio sent me the last figure that has appeared in the newspaper, we have more than 10,000 castles in Spain. There are wind castles, big castles, small castles. So we have so much. We have so much monasteries. We have more than 10,000 Romanesque churches. So imagine, in the rural areas, we are going to lose huge amount of heritage in the next years. It's impossible to stop this process. So we are facing this problems, and maybe you can say, okay, we are going to keep in good condition the urban heritage inside the historic center or similar. Really not. We can see everywhere the old villages that are decaying because the people is no longer living there. So we have many, many, many challenges for the future. Antonio, dale. This picture is only to see what is the condition of the problem in terms of the population. You can see a line from the UK to Italy, where most of the people in this X, most of the people in Europe is living. You can see there, Spain. You can see that people is living more in the coastal areas, and in some points in the middle. In the middle is Madrid, and the rest of the area is going to be the populated. These kind of projects, for example, INT-HERIT, talking about small cities or medium cities, is very important, because for us it's necessary to maintain a network of small cities all around Europe in order to maintain the sustainability of the territory. For us it's very important, but this is only a topic for reflection. Okay, what is our vision? We need to activate heritage, landscape and people. And we cannot focus only on heritage, because the heritage is inside a landscape that is different from a place to other, and the people have produce the landscape and the heritage that is inside. So this is a mixture. We cannot forget one of these elements. For us, territory is the physical element that keeps the people inside on the heritage, on the landscape. This territory is a concept that is transformed by the people. So it's important to focus more than in single elements. The single heritage elements is more important to focus on the territories. And we face these territorial challenges taking the memory, taking the heritage, the elements, the things that have the people in these territories. We try to put in value, to involve the people that is living there, and trying to find new ways to earn the life in these territories in order to maintain the people there, maintain the landscape, and maintain the heritage inside. And this is the golden cycle, which explain why we do that. We are the custody, the wards of this territory. We feel us that we have this mission to ward the elements that are useful in the territories in order to pass these elements to the future. We try to implement programs that are focusing on all the elements, and we try to innovate to find new solutions to face the challenges that in the 21st century are arising. And this is the method that we are using today. It's a method in which we try to understand what is happening, to involve people inside the territories, apply the solutions, measure and evaluate. It's the same process that in the project management, and we try to make this systemic change, a change that goes inside all the problems in the territory. So, with this presentation, we can talk about if even the ruins can be a hope or not. So, thank you very much.
Okay, we'd like us now to promote the discussion. Like Miguel said earlier, we like that you at the end put a post-it on this poster with your main idea or conclusion, what you get from this presentation, in order that we, in a way of capturing the knowledge or the exchange of knowledge that we are promoting here. So we'd like now to make, you can make some questions to Mr. Gumersindo, and we are going to start with the experts, and then you can follow by asking questions or comment, whatever you want.
Yep. So first, thank you for the presentation. That was really, really interesting. And when you mentioned about this integrated approach of heritage, landscape, and people, where do you put here the financial part, the way you guarantee sustainability?
The financial part is very important, of course. It's necessary to make sustainable projects. And we are working today more than looking to public funding. That is necessary in the starting point, it's necessary, of course. We are more focused on entrepreneurship. It's important that the use of heritage and landscape is to produce something. If not, you are going to have a problem. Mm-hmm. It's necessary to put entrepreneurship in the key point of these projects. For us, it's clear. Social entrepreneurship, private, normal entrepreneurship, but it's necessary. Of course, in the first phase of this project, it's necessary to put some public money because you need to study, you need to involve people, you need to change the mind of people. Today, we have been called by the regional authority in Castilla León because they want our help in order to promote the activity in an area in the north area of Castilla León that is what's a traditional coal mining area. So they are closing the mines. And the people is looking for new opportunities. Most of the people is going to disappear from the territory. So for us, we need to, the key point is to change the mind, to see how many opportunities you can find in your territory using your resources, natural, cultural, and social resources in order to create new business, new opportunities. So, it's clear. We need entrepreneurship.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Anyone? Okay.
I have one question.
Can you speak so you don't have to move around?
Heritage. As I understand, maybe you can clarify me well. Do you also create a specialist in traditional working, I don't know, blacksmiths, for restoration of buildings?
The mission of the workshop school was to recover new old trades, masonry, this kind of trades that have disappeared in the last part of the century, in the last century in Spain. So the people without employment, they started to learn, you know. In the 80s, the main problem is in Spain was unemployment. But one type of unemployment that was with the young people without a profession, without skills, people that have lived the traditional educational model. And in this situation, there was plenty of young people without a profession. This was a great opportunity to recover all trades, heritage buildings, and to offer these people a new opportunity. And most of these people have been working in the building sector after that, restoring or creating new buildings. And many, many people, the directors of the workshops, the schools, today are local development agencies, they are politicians. They are. It was a very interesting program because it has had a big impact on preparing people for new opportunities.
And for this you have the government support?
Yes, it was supported by the government. It was supported by the government and the regional authorities. Yeah. Today, the need of this type of projects is different. After the evolution of this program, that today is still working in some regions, we are not promoting anymore this kind of programs. But in this case, this type of programs are not so useful. Because in Spain we don't have the same problem than the 80s, and there was the most of the main heritage elements have been recovered with this program and others. So we need to adapt the programs to reality and the needs and the social needs. So for us, we stopped promoting workshops in schools 20 years ago. The government still is working on that, and it was very useful, for example, in Latin America, South America, that the Spanish international aid have been developing this kind of programs all around Latin America, Africa, and other places. But we need to change we need to identify the problems and the social needs, and after that, we must design the programs, trying to be innovative and resolve the problems that we are facing. So in this case, career boosters, when we face the problem of unemployment in Spain, the last 5 years, we have changed the focus. We decided not to restore buildings again. We have been thinking about energy refurbishment or whatever. In this case, we have detected that the people unemployed after the crisis, the economic crisis, was people very well prepared, very well with plenty of skills, plenty of knowledge, out of university people, with master, whatever, and they were unemployed. So we decided to work only with them in order to recover the, how do you say, autoestima?
Self-esteem.
Okay. So self-esteem, and with coaching models, another work group, another strategies, we have developed and we have reached levels of return to the employment of 60%. So we need to adapt our response, with the answer to the need of the new needs.
Any more questions?
Hi, thanks for the presentation. Can I have a few questions? First question was, how long, your project's fantastic, the way that it was going in the monastery. How long did it take from inception to completion? What was the budget in relation to the funding? Who was the lead partner? And also, how did you go to sort of try and involve the community from the start?
Yeah.
A few questions.
Yeah, no, I understand perfectly. Starting from the end, the people start to think about restore this monument, the neighbors of the Aguilar de Campo, and this was nearly a movement, natural movement of the people that started to think about what they have. Aguilar de Campo is a national monument, the small village itself, and this is another movement. So this was a natural movement of the people, with the leadership of José María Pérez González, that was our former president. The time that took to restore the building, more or less 10 years. 10 years, and the funding was public, most of them. It was a public funding because the use of this element was going to be public at the end. So it's a clear situation that, you know, are in the 80s, in the last century, it was usual that the public funding covered these needs. Today, we don't have a lot of public funding for restoring elements. So we need to look to other people, other entities that can help us on restoring that. And maybe the question is, should we continue restoring elements, heritage elements, without thinking in the use and without a business model to maintain these elements?
So the policy is not to restore again and again new monuments, but to consolidate the projects.
The problem is that the public administration don't have a lot of money for that. So we used to go there, and the restoring companies go to the public administration, give me more money. We don't have money. Oh, no, we need your money to restore that. Okay, this is a cycle that is impossible to keep and maintain. I think we should think on business model to use the restored elements before starting the restoration. The point is not to look for the money. The point is to look for the use. I think if we change the point, había una pregunta por ahí.
Yeah, thank you for your presentation. I'm interested in the skills development, the cultivated American skills development. When you did that, because you know, we're doing some work with that on waterways and canals. Did you work with the local education authorities?
It was an alternative way of qualifying the people. You know, this program started in the 80s, last century, and at this time there was not very developed vocational training. So it was the first attempt to create a new way to people who have lived the educational system to gain education and gain skills. So it was in parallel. So today, the system to qualify people is the vocational process, vocational training, and professional training outside the educational process. In this way, the professional education outside the education model is are included the workshop schools. Today we have professional certificates that are recognized in parallel to the educational certificates. So, in this professional certificates, we can put the workshop schools today.
Thank you very much for coming today here. It's not easy after holidays to reorganize our agenda and spend 1 or 2 days in another project. So thank you, and thank you also to come from a rural area, like your area, your territory with similar, more or less, problems. I have 2 questions. The first one is about if you have any experience or have you participated in some project in which you can develop, or you have developed, some public, private, or social partnership in the management sector in cultural heritage. And the second one is about your experience with the master degree with some universities about the reorientation of professionals in the cultural heritage sector, facilitating a new career oriented to the management sector.
Okay. First, you mean public and private partnership? How we can develop that? we have the experience of Romanes, Atlantic Romanes. That is a program in which the government of Portugal, the government of the region of Castilla y León, and the Fundación Iberdrola, with us, we have been working together to restore a group of Romanesque churches in Portugal and in Spain. So this is the clear, it's a clear partnership in which we are working that. Also, we have been working in partnership with other entities like Fundación Endesa and other entities that are the former Fundación Caja Madrid. You know that institution that was very important and very active on funding heritage projects, and we have been working with all of this. We have now a problem with the administration. We can find money to put on heritage or on rural development, but sometimes we have problems with the laws related to the public contracts and different points. It's a problem. Administration in Europe is talking about public and private partnership, but in Spain we have problems in order to put in reality, because we have the Spanish law of contract, similar to the European law of contracts, and it cannot recognize that when an entity like us can take money in order to develop a project, we cannot offer publicly this money in order to make the projects. And the second point, in relation with the heritage in the master of skills on heritage management that we have promoted with three universities in Castilla y León. What we want to do with this master is to give all the professionals and students that want to work on the heritage sector skills on management. The same that is usual to take an MBA, for example, for someone that is going to work in a different sector. This should be necessary to the people who is going to manage the heritage elements. Why? Because if not, you are going to have a partial point of view in your management. For example, if you are a restorer, you are going to focus more on restoration. If you are an architect, you are going to focus more on architectural questions. A manager that is a hub of knowledge, a manager should know a little bit thing about these all knowledge areas, but put together in order to manage and balance the results of the management of this heritage. It's our view for the future that professionals of management should be in charge of management of these elements in order to keep the sustainability. It's not possible to maintain the management of heritage buildings or heritage assets only with public money. It's not possible. And a heritage manager must know about architecture, risk, monitoring, communication, accountability, everything. Everything that put together helps to manage the heritage elements.
Yes, I have two questions. One is about the volunteer work and the civil movement. The one you described, I think it started many years ago.
Yeah.
Do you also have more recent experiences, and has it changed the way you work with the volunteers and so on? And this is one question. And the other question is about, you mentioned a project on the heritage monitoring system.
Yeah.
Can you tell us about a little bit?
Okay, in relation with volunteers, you know, we were talking about the 80s and the 70s in last century. Many people that were volunteers and they don't have an invitation to re-qualify themselves on heritage restoring or whatever. The process in my entity has been the following. starting with people, volunteer people and students, we have been growing on professionality and we professionalize all the staff. So today it's not possible because we have laws in relation to building activities or restaurant activities, it's not possible to put there volunteers because you don't need. But it's a question of change. A lot of change have happened from the 80s to today. So we have professionalized this area. And today we are working with volunteers on career booster. Career booster, the program in order to help people to recover their employment, is spent with volunteers because it's not dangerous for them. And the recent, the second question was the monitoring system. This is a system that we have developed. It's hardware and software. We have been working with small sensors and nodes in order to take the information from the building and send the information to central servers in order to transform this information in knowledge. We want to know what happened on the monuments. Why we started this? It's a question of need, again. As you have seen before, we have been working on 54 small rural churches all around an area, a big area. It was impossible to visit the churches every day or once a week. It was impossible because it's very expensive. And we started to think, if we can monitorize what is happening inside the building from the environmental issues, humidity, light,
humidity.
And structural issues. We control all these elements, and also we can check if somebody is going inside the building, taking something. It's not a security system like an alarm system. It's different. It's more less sophisticated, and we don't, because in Spain again the law doesn't permit these activities of security for entities like us. So the need of controlling what was happening in the small churches all around the rural areas, in some villages that there was no people living there, it was a need that helped us to develop this system. This is a technical question with I cannot explain this because it's an engineering system and I don't know really the small questions, but I don't know if you have clear what is the aim of this system.
Can I just add a comment? We are looking here for a different system, not a more technical one that you described right now, but also to monitor results, to monitor the impacts of the actions and the projects, for instance in job creation. So it's more in a management point of view instead of more practical management of the buildings. Of course, this is also important in our project, but this is one of the main goals of our project is to try to build a simple but a system that can give you some information of the impact, because this is the problem. And I would like to know if you measure these impacts, because you are so focused on job creation, for instance, which is more or less simple to measure by looking at statistics. But anyway, do you have, or do you plan to do some kind of evaluation at this level?
We are starting with this, kind of evaluation methods, and we try to implant the SROI, social return of investment. This is a method that is working today, and we are going to use. We are using this kind of thing. For example, in Career Booster, we have evaluated employment, return to studies. For example, if you that is a criteria of that. But also we are monitoring change of paradigms, mental paradigms. We have detected that in Carrie Rooster, for example, the people change their minds in some topics like equality, other topics that before and after the Carrie Rooster program, we can check this with sociology instruments in order to evaluate that.
Just more qualitative evaluation.
Yeah, we have quantitative and qualitative evaluation. And in the case of heritage management, also on territorial development, I think social return on investment could be a good strategy. Also, maybe complemented with the evaluation of the qualitative change in the way the people are thinking on the territories.
I think you do it by inquiring the population.
Yeah.
Anyone? One more question, please.
Can you tell me the formal type of legal jobs? The formal type, are they private jobs? Are they cooperative jobs? The type of,
in
of
our entity.
Legal jobs that were created?
In our entity. We are a private foundation.
Not you.
No. Oh, okay. No. We try to develop normal private business. We are on the third sector, and we are a social entity, and we are. But the rules of Spain, the law of Spain, we are in a normal, it's a foundation, but we are using the normal law of employment, okay? But we promote the activity in the territories, whatever.
I mean, they want to work together in a cooperative, or they prefer to...
Today in Spain...
Today
in Spain, we can say that cooperatives are not the key points, are more for private business. For me, personally, cooperative is a very good system, but we have detected the lack of culture on cooperativism, and maybe today, more in a different situation, people want to create their own business, run this business.
You said you have been restoring 45 churches. The function of these buildings, it remains for church services, or do you have churches where you have new functions?
Yeah. We have restored more. Of course, I have mentioned the North Romanesque, that are 54 churches recovered, and they are used for religious purposes. We have here in Spain a problem with the owner of the most of the part of the heritage elements, talking about the building heritage, that the owner is the Catholic Church, and this is a problem. I can't say it anymore.
In the country, we have less church doors than, let's say, 30 years ago. So some churches are closing,
yeah.
And they are consolidating services in one main church, and then smaller churches are closing.
Yeah.
So communities, together with the Catholic Church, have to look for new functions to maintain the building. And,
yeah.
That's not an evolution you see here in Spain, or it's something that is coming?
Our priests are too old to change their minds. I think it's a problem today. Because, you know, in every small village you can find 1, 2, 3, 4 churches, and there are no people there. So it's a problem. This is what I was trying to say. We cannot keep a good standing 6,000 churches in Castilla y León. It's impossible to maintain. We need to choose what are more important. I think it's a point, a moment, we are going to choose what kind or what type of heritage we are going to maintain. It's impossible to maintain all the heritage. It's not possible. And in the case of the Catholic Church used to ask for public funding for restoring the buildings, but you know, they are private buildings. You can imagine, I could go to the administration, I have a beautiful house, a little money. Oh, you are a private day. But you have give a lot of money to a private owner, that is the church, the Catholic Church. But it's not a question today in Spain.
I wanted to hear about the question that you actually put up in the beginning of the presentation. How can you be sure that the restoration of the heritage is the right way? We also have an example where we actually are having a heritage which are really good, and that has been at some point renovated a little bit. And there's a huge discussion of whether to leave the heritage as it is and just to make sure that it is safe, or whether the second opinion, of course, is okay, we have to restore or the volume of the building and so on. And but there's so many details when we restore the historical building. What's your opinion on that?
My opinion is that important. Okay, we should maintain certain type of elements that are unique. But the rest of the elements that are not unique, we should try to think about the use of these elements before investing money on them. So, my idea is, if you don't have a clear future use of this, a new use, it's better not to put money there, because we don't have infinitive money. I don't know if I have answered your question.
My point was more than probably the place is with a good potential of visitors. It still is active place. I'm talking about. You have two options, whether to, I don't know, find a way how to keep the ruins, or whether to, I don't know, restore the volume of the
I know the architect, I'm restorer, I'm project manager and lawyer. So it's my free point of view. I couldn't do more than consolidate in the case that is not necessary more. Following the criteria, for example, in UK it's usual to consolidate ruins, and if you are not going to use more, this building no, you don't need to restore more. It's my point of view. It's a personal point of view. You need to put the money, because I suppose you don't have a huge amount of money to invest on your country, like us or like others. You need to put the money in what are, first, those monuments that are unique, for example, Alhambra, L'Escorial, other monuments, and in the rest of the monuments, in the rest of the heritage, you should keep in mind the use and the return of the investment. Social return on the investment, okay. But some return on the return.
But I also have a question. Isn't that the monument our identity that represents us as a nation? So we put away that.
No. Okay. Some that is representative of your identity, so you need to maintain. Okay. But you know, I have told you before, we have 10,000 of castles, more than 10,000 of Romanesque churches, a huge amount of medieval bridges, plenty of traditional villages. We need to choose. We don't have money for all of that.
Who chooses?
Who's choosing? The public administration.
Yeah, when you speak of the 10,000 of castles and the question of whether we need to preserve them all, the problem there is that each single castle is forming an important part of the identity of the local community of where the castle is. So you can say we have 10,000 castles, we choose to preserve only the 1,000 most beautiful or whatever criteria you use, and whoever selects or scores these criteria. But then you will have 9,000 communities that lose their critical part of.
Maybe we are talking about different realities. Because I'm talking about in those places where the community has disappeared. That is the problem in Spain and in other places. There are many, many places where the people is disappearing, and this is a global trend. The people is going to live in the macro urban areas in 50 years. It is the UNESCO said, the ONU said.
From Belgium, so which is one big city, so we're not really confronted with that.
I think we should involve the communities and ask them. We need to ask to the community, what do you want to do with this castle? Are you willing to put money? Do you want to increase your taxes in order to restore the castle?
Yes,
who pays?
It also can bring money to that community.
Okay, it can bring money. The heritage could boost the local economy. We agree with that, and we restore things. But we are thinking always in the future use, maybe, to create a landscape, cultural landscape in the territory, to create a tourist brand that you can promote and you can attract people. Yes, in these cases, heritage helps to the community in order to find new ways of earning the life. Okay, perfect. This is perfect, but you need to think about what are you going to do with this village.
Have a strategy.
This is a good word.